I'm good. See everybody coming in. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, Come on in on Facebook, come on in and Zoom. Praise God for all of you all joining us here this morning. See Mother Latta and Apostle Latta in there. Praise God, Lisa, James, hey, praise the Lord, Apostle Latta says, praise the Lord to everybody. All right, come on in, Right, just give everybody a few minutes to get on in here. Praise the Lord, Lori. Hi, how are you doing? All right, praise the Lord, everybody. See Elder Jill in here. Praise the Lord, Praise the Lord, Sister Blackwell. Praise the Lord, Brittany. Hey, Charles and Janice, praise the Lord. Danny, hey, praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord. Come on in, Sister Huff, David, amen. Praise the Lord, Sister Clay, Brother Finch, hey, how you doing, Keith? Praise the Lord, Pam and Glenn, praise the Lord. Sister Austin, hey, how you doing? Brother Bostic, hey, how you doing, my brother? God bless you. Amen. Sister Lowe, praise the Lord. I see TJ in here. I see Elder Wilder, praise the Lord. Sister Celia, amen, praise the Lord. I see everybody coming on here. Amen. Praise God for you all coming and joining us on this Memorial Day weekend. Praise the Lord, amen. Praise the Lord, All right, hey. This is Bible Way Church right here in Columbus, Ohio, and I am Pastor Tim Latta, and so we're just going to just be in worship right here in this sanctuary. I guess sort of getting used to this new normal, if you will, just being here in the sanctuary without everybody else, but you all joining us online, so praise God for you all joining us online each and every week. Praise God for that. We're going to start with a word of prayer, if you don't mind. God, we thank you, God, for all that you have done. We thank you, God, for keeping us. We thank you, God, for your provision, your power. We thank you, God, for keeping us healthy and safe, God. We ask, Lord, those of us that are struggling during this time, God, financially, emotionally, Lord God, physically, we ask, God, that you bring healing and wholeness in the name of Jesus. We pray and we thank you, God, for all that you have done and what you have yet to do in us and through us during this time. We thank you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Praise the Lord, everybody. Hey, well, I'm going to jump right into this word that we got this morning, and I want you to join with me. We're going to look right here in the book of Luke, Luke chapter number 19. Luke chapter number 19 is where we're going to look. Luke 19 verses, beginning in verse number 1, we're going to start there and go all the way down to verse number 10. It says, "And Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. And behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, which was the chief among the publicans. He was rich, and he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the press. There was a lot of people that were gathering around, and so he could not get close to Jesus. He was a short man, much like myself. He was pretty short, and so he was trying to see Jesus, but he was. He said he was little in stature. They were trying to be nice to him. He was little in stature. Right? And so he ran before and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must abide at thy house. And he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they murmured, saying that he was gone to be guest with a man that is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor, and if I have taken anything from any man by false accusations, I restore him fourfold. And Jesus said unto him, This day is salvation come to this house. For as much as he also is the son of Abraham, for the son of man is come to seek and to save that which is or which was lost. Well, I want to thank you all for joining us here on Facebook and on Zoom this morning. Happy Memorial Day, everybody. We want to thank all of our service men and women that have served this country and left this continent and left this country and served the people here in the United States, all around the world. We thank all of our essential workers. We want to remember them as well during this weekend as well. The hospital workers, cafeteria workers, the doctors, the nurses, police and fire, nursing home workers, and adult daycare, and also daycare workers as well. Adult caregivers and also daycare workers, grocery store workers, and all of you that are essential in keeping this country running. We just want to say thank you. Thank you for all that you do. Thank you for sacrificing your time and some of you even your health and even your life for others. And so we praise God for that. In these scriptures that we read today, we find a man by the name of Zacchaeus. He is a man widely known for, he's not widely known for a miracle or some kind of prophetic word. He's not known as one of the 12 disciples. He was not in the upper room when the Holy Spirit descended and came down on the day of Pentecost. He was just a man that came in contact with Jesus. He was just a man that came in contact with Jesus. He was in the right place at the right time. And the encounter that he had with Jesus changed his life forever. This morning, I want to talk to you on the topic, real change. We've been talking about change over the last few weeks. So I want to talk about real change, real change. Real change is not just when you feel bad and you cry, when you thought about the grace of God. That's not real change. Real change is not when you come to Jesus, when you are facing some jail time or when you're facing some kind of health crisis that has or life-threatening illness. No, not that kind of change. Although sometimes it takes those things to bring about the real change. Some of us, unless our health is threatened, then we will change the way we eat or change the fact that we need to exercise and take care of ourselves. So sometimes those things help, but the kind of change that I'm talking about here this morning is the one in which you accept the Lord Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and he changes your life for the better. The Dalai Lama once said this. He said that real change in the world only comes from a change of heart. It only comes from a change of heart, and I think that is true, but the greatest agent of change is Jesus Christ. He has changed more hearts from stubborn. He has changed more hearts from bitter, from angry, more hearts from sinful, from sinful hearts than any other person in history. And so John 3:16 says, For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believed in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And so this morning, I want to talk to you about a man by the name of Zacchaeus and the real change which this man encountered. Some of you, all might have only know Zacchaeus from that song. You remember that song from Children's Church? Zacchaeus was a wee little man. A wee little man was he. He climbed up into a sycamore tree just to see what he could see. But as the Savior came that way, he looked up into that tree and he said, Zacchaeus, you come down there. You come down from there, for I'm coming to your house today. I don't know where I found, where I heard you coming to, I'm coming to your house for tea from. I don't know where that came from, but I heard that before. Well, I'm coming from your to your house for tea. But what caused this, it's mind-boggling. What caused this dignified tax collector to climb his dignified self up into a tree to get a look at Jesus? What caused this man to run and climb up into a tree? I'm sure he had some fine clothes on. Climb up into a tree. I'm sure other people are looking at him. What in the world is wrong with you? Climb up into a tree just to get a look at Jesus. What would cause this man to lay aside his pride just to hear what Jesus had to say? And I'm sure that he had heard how Jesus had raised the dead. I'm sure he heard how he had cleansed the lepers. I'm sure he heard how Jesus had walked on water and delivered those that were demon-possessed. And so he climbed himself up into this sycamore tree to see Jesus. Now, one thing that you must that you can say about tax collectors, at least at that time, is that they were not very well liked. They were public enemy number one. They were looked at as traitors. They were looked at as people that were working alongside the Roman government that wasn't even concerned with their own people. They were looking at them as sharks that were trying to take advantage of people. That's the way that they were looked at that time. And so he was despised in his own community. He was that's what was going on there in this scene. Zacchaeus was he was despised amongst his people. If you don't believe me, look at the reaction of the people that heard that Jesus was going to have dinner with this man. Luke chapter number 19, verse number 7. It says, "And when they saw it, they murmured, saying that he was gone to be guest with a man that is a sinner." They were looking at him and said, "Jesus, why are you going to fool with this guy? Of all the people here, well, you can come to my house, you can come to her house, you can come to his house, you can go anywhere else. Why are you going to hang around with this sinner?" It's like that nowadays. Jesus said, "You know what? I want to go and talk to this person who is a drunk, this person who is strung out on drugs. I want to have dinner with this person that is a prostitute. I want to have dinner with this person that is living in sin. I want to hang out with this person." But the first thing we need to know this morning is that God can change anybody. I want you to hear that. I want you to understand that God can change anybody. Nobody's past is too dark. Nobody's past is too bleak. Nobody's past is not too troublesome. Your past. It is not too convoluted. It is not too full of confusion. It's not so troublesome that the love of God cannot change you. I want you to understand that. Ezekiel 36 and 26 says this: "A new heart also will I give to you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh." God can change anybody, even you. Even you. I haven't been to church in years. Even you. I haven't been perfect. Even you. I messed up this morning. Even you. God can change anybody. Yes, he can. Ezekiel 36 says he can take that stony heart and turn it into flesh. That means that only God can take the most difficult person. Think of the most difficult person to deal with that you know. Think about that most difficult person that you know. The most angry, the most depressed, the most downtrodden, the most angry, the most vengeful, the most spiteful. Think about the most angry person that you know. That person, God can turn that person around. God can change that person. We always sing that song, "If you can use anything, Lord, you can use me." But then when it comes to that person that hurt you, you're not too interested in that. God, you can't change that person. Why? Because they hurt me. No. God can change anybody. God can change anybody. Even the most difficult person, God can change. Look at what God did to the Apostle Paul on the Damascus Road. He took a man that was completely bent toward destroying the church. He was speaking words of murdering. He had an arrest warrant to arrest anybody that spoke the name of Jesus. And God got a hold of him on the Damascus Road and turned him around into becoming one of the greatest apostles. How do you do that? How do you take the person that is the most against what you're trying to do, and take that one, win him over to your side, turn him around, and make him the greatest advocate for the kingdom of God? Only God can do that. I say that this morning because I want you to hear me. Brothers and sisters, don't give up on your sons and daughters. Don't give up on your nieces and your nephews. Don't give up on your cousins and them. Don't give up on those people that might be strung out on drugs. Don't give up on those that might be bound by alcoholism. Don't give up on those that, they might be abusive today. But guess what? Let God get a hold of them. If God gets a hold of them, God can turn them completely around. If God gets a hold of them, a great change can come over them. Think about this. If God can change you, what can he do for somebody else? Because you ain't always been perfect either. If God can change you, God can change somebody else. 2 Corinthians 5 and 17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. And behold, all things can become new. That means that God can give you a complete and utter makeover. I'm sure that some of you have all encountered some people that proclaim Christ and say that they are Christians, but their actions reflect otherwise. Their words reflect otherwise. But if you really want to know if somebody's salvation is legit, if their salvation is genuine, just watch them. Just watch them. If their heart is different, if they talk different, if the way in which they talk is different, and the way their actions are different, when God saves you, God does a thorough job. You don't have to question. You don't have to question if it's real or not. You can see it. You don't have to question if it's real or not. You can hear it. You don't have to question whether it's real or not. Their life is displaying it. When God saves you, he does a thorough job. Philippians 1 and 6 says, being confident of this very thing, that he which has begun a good work in you, he will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. And so the Bible says that Zacchaeus climbed up into a tree. But not only that, Luke chapter number 19, verse number 3 and 4, it says he sought to see Jesus. He just wanted to see Jesus, who he was. And he could not for the press because he was little in stature. And so he ran up ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him. For he was to pass that way. Another thing I want you to see this morning is this. I want you to understand is that real change requires persistence. I know a lot of people don't want to hear that word. Real change requires persistence. There's got to be something in you that makes you keep on going when everything in you tells you you need to quit. If you're ever going to change anything, it's going to require persistence. Philippians 3 and 14 says this. It says, I pressed toward the mark. Paul had been up and down. Paul had been arrested. Paul had been assaulted. Paul had had people for him, people against him. Paul had people plot against him. People had said, Paul, we're with you 100%. And then he turned around and now they're trying to stab him in the back. And that was Paul. But Paul said, I pressed toward the mark for the prize of the high calling in Christ Jesus. Pressing is using persistence. Persistence is the ability to stick with it even when things become difficult. A man by the name of Yuri Yang once was quoted as saying this, if a caterpillar can eat a leaf one bite at a time, surely you can overcome your challenges one step at a time. Whatever it is, if a caterpillar can eat a leaf one bite at a time, you can overcome your challenges one step at a time. What I'm saying is this, it's not going to happen overnight. It may not happen overnight. It may not happen in the first week. It may not happen in the first month. But be persistent. Stick with it. Don't give up. Have you ever said that you were going to lay off the sweets or the fatty foods? And that's when people come around with donuts and candy and all kinds of snacks and things like that. Have you ever said you're going to change your spending habits or leave that alcohol alone? Change is difficult. It is. It's difficult. Change of direction is difficult. It's difficult. Whatever you're trying to change, it is difficult because it demands a change of behavior, a conscious decision to do something different. It does. It requires you to do something different. Whatever you're trying to do, whether it's lose weight, trying to learn a new language, during this time of quarantine, I hope you're doing something. I see the sign just the other day. It said, don't ever let a crisis go to waste. Do something during this time. Do something during this time to improve yourself. Do something during this time to improve your surroundings, improve the people around you. But it's going to require persistence. Cheryl James was once quoted as saying this, change is not an event, it's a process. It's not just something that happens overnight, it's a process. It's a process. Change is not an event, it's not you show up at change. No, it's a process. It's a process. It is continued and sustained effort over time. Zacchaeus was present, was persistent because he had a plan to run ahead of the crowd. He just had to see Jesus. Know this, that whatever you try to change, everybody may not go with you. He had to go ahead of the crowd. He had to leave some things behind. He had to leave his pride behind. He had to leave some people behind. He had to leave his status behind. Real change sometimes requires that you walk alone. Real change sometimes requires that you walk alone. Psalms 20:7 says, some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God. I'm encouraging this morning to be persistent. Don't give up. Don't give out. Don't give in. Don't back down. Everything that God has promised you, it shall come to pass. So here is the key. It's up in this tree. And when Jesus passes by, he couldn't help but to notice this man is seemingly out of place. This man in his fine garments, this man in his stature in the community, this man that seemingly would not want to have anything to do with Jesus, this man was seemingly out of place, not just physically, but also spiritually. He was looking for something more than just to see Jesus. He was looking to have an encounter with Jesus. He wanted to find out what Jesus was all about. Luke chapter number 19, verse number 5-7, it says that when Jesus came into the place, he looked up and he saw him and he said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste, come down, for today I must abide at thy house. And he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. When they saw it, they murmured, saying that he was gone to be a guest with a man that is a sinner. Zacchaeus immediately began to make major life changes after his encounter with Jesus. What has happened since you had an encounter with Jesus? Zacchaeus recognized that the way that he was living was flawed. Anytime you spend some time with Jesus, anytime you spend some time in the Word of God, anytime you spend some time in prayer, it's like a mirror showing you yourself. You'll see that, hey, I haven't made it. I'm not all that yet. I still have a way to go. How enlightened is that? Sometimes it takes something major to happen before people realize that our life is not beneficial to our health, that we're not being productive on our job, that this relationship is not going anywhere, not helping us spiritually, that something is not helping us spiritually, but is leaving us empty and not fulfilled. And so Zacchaeus had an awakening, if you will, after his encounter with Jesus. Luke chapter number 19, verse number 8 and 10, it says, Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, behold, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I have taken anything from any man by false accusations, I restore him fourfold. And Jesus said unto him, this day is salvation come to this house, for as much as he also is the son of Abraham, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which is lost. Last thing I want you to hear this morning is that if you seek him, not only will you find him, but guess what? He'll also find you. I know it's not Christmas time, but I know you need to hear this. Wise men still seek him. I know that we are in the middle of a national crisis. I know that the economy is up and down and all over the place. But wise men still seek him. Wise men and women are still seeking after to hear wisdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. Matthew 7 says this, Matthew 7:7-8 says, ask and ye shall be given you, seek and ye shall find, knock and the door shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth, he that seeketh, findeth, and him that knocketh, it shall be opened. What Zacchaeus sought was just a glimpse of Jesus, but what he got was even more valuable. Zacchaeus was a very rich man. He was. Jesus never asked him to give up his wealth. He never asked him to give up his possessions or his goods to the poor. He did it voluntarily. Jesus never asked him to restore anything that he took from the people falsely. He took whatever he took falsely and gave it back fourfold. He did it voluntarily. He did it because he experienced a real change. And when he looked around and he seen people that were without, when he seen people that were in need, he had to do something about it. That's the definition of compassion. That's the definition of compassion. That's the definition. Yeah. God looks at our pitiful state and he does something about it. That's grace. When we experience real change, you strive to make things right with the people around you. You'll make it right. You'll try to make it right with the people that hurt you or the people that you hurt. When you experience real change, you'll forgive those people that will not forgive you. You'll forgive the people that hurt you. You'll bury the hatchet. When you experience real change, you've got to love your enemies. When you experience real change, you'll do some things that other people might not understand. But because you experience real change, the love of God on the inside of you, you've got to do something to help somebody else. Everybody doesn't experience real change. If you look at Matthew chapter number 19, you'll see the rich young ruler that it talked about in Matthew 19 and 16. It says, behold, one came and said unto him, good master, what good thing shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? And so Jesus told him the commandments. And he told him the commandments and in Matthew 19, 18 and 19, it says, and he said unto him, which Jesus said, thou shalt do no murder, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness. Honor thy father and thy mother, and thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. The man started feeling pretty good about himself. He started patting himself on the chest. Yes, I'm doing pretty good here. I checked all the boxes. I'm checking the boxes. Yeah, I haven't murdered anybody. Yeah, I haven't committed adultery. Yeah, I'm not stealing from anybody. I'm not bearing false witness. I'm not scandalizing anybody's name. I'm honoring my father and my mother. I'm loving my neighbor as myself. So he said, but he still wanted more. He said, there's got to be more than that. Am I missing anything, Jesus? He said, am I missing anything? What else am I missing? Is there anything else that I can do that can keep me from going to heaven? Is there anything that is hindering hindering my salvation? Jesus simply said this in Matthew chapter number 19, verse number 21. And 22, he said this, Jesus said, if thou wilt be perfect, sell that thou hast and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me. And when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. And this man, what this man never realized is that it was not about his goods. It was not about his possessions. It was not about his wealth. Anybody can do good deeds. It was not about all the good deeds that he did. It was not about his money. It was not all about the influence that he had or the possessions that he had. Jesus didn't want his money. He has cattle on 1,000 hills. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. What Jesus really wanted was his heart. He wanted his heart, the heart of this rich young ruler. He wanted the heart. And that's what he wants from you. He wants your heart. We all have a heart condition. We need to go back to our first love and return our hearts to Jesus. Matthew 6:33 says this, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. If you seek Jesus, not only will you find him, but he'll find you. When Zacchaeus began to repent of his sins, now his heart began to be bent toward Jesus. Luke 19, 9 and 10 says this. It says, and Jesus said unto him, this day is salvation come into this house. For as much also as the Son of Man, as he is also a son of man, son of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which is lost. Half the battle is just realizing that you're lost. Half the battle is just realizing that you're lost. Half the battle is realizing that you're a sinner in need of a Savior. All of us are just a bunch of sinners that are saved by grace. Ephesians 2 and 8 says, for by grace are you saved through faith. It is the gift of God. Salvation is a gift. It's a free gift. There's no strings attached. The Lord just wants you to live for him, to give your life to him. The real change, that's the real change. The real change of salvation is that your life, your heart is now bent toward Jesus Christ. And now you're living for him. Real change. The Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg once said this, real change happens one step at a time. It doesn't happen overnight. You change over time. Don't be so hard on yourself. You change over time. Let the Lord begin to work on you today, starting today, and watch what God will do. Let him begin to change your heart right here today, your mind right here today, and watch what God will do one step at a time. One day at a time, one moment, one week at a time, one moment by moment, one day by day, God will change you. He'll turn that stony heart into flesh. As I close here this morning, I want you to know that if you have the faith to believe, God can save you. If you have faith to believe, God can change you. He can change you in prison. He can change you in your alcoholism. He can change you in the middle of your rage. He can change you in the middle of your promiscuity. He can change you in the midst of whatever your sin is, your lying, your lack of faith, your doubt. God is able to change you. If you have faith to believe, God can forgive you and restore you. He can fill you with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I invite you this morning, if you haven't already accepted the Lord into your life, to accept the Lord into your life today. Ask the Lord to forgive you of your sins. Romans 10 and 13 says this, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Hebrews 3 and 15 says, today, when you hear my voice, harden not your heart. Some of you, the Lord has been calling. The Lord has been trying to implore you, trying to move you to surrender your life to him. Today is the day. Give your life to the Lord. He'll change your life for the better. Starting today. Don't wait until tomorrow. Start today. Don't wait until next week. Start today. Don't wait until all the churches are open back up. Start today. Allow the Lord to enter into your life. We are the church. We are the body of Christ. Call on the Lord. He'll meet you right where you are. If you're up in a tree, like Zacchaeus, he'll meet you right there. If you're down in the valley, like Joseph, down in the pit, he'll meet you there. He'll meet you on the Damascus Road, like Paul. He'll meet you on the backside of the desert, like Abraham. He'll meet you on the backside of the desert. He'll meet you in the wilderness, like Moses. He'll meet you right where you are. Right where you are. You know. And God knows right where you are this morning. Let's pray. Pray with me if you would. Oh God, we thank you. We ask, oh God, that you allow your people to experience real change. Not change that comes with government turnover. Not change that comes with change of economy. Not change that comes with a new job or a new spouse. Not change that comes with a change of address. But a change that comes from an encounter with the Almighty God. Forgive us of our sins. Help us, oh God, to surrender to you. Lord God, that we might live for you. Change our mind. Change our way of thinking. Change our way of living. Help us, oh God, to live a life that is set apart for the Master's use. That we might be the called out ones. Calling those that are out of darkness into this most marvelous light. We thank you and we praise your God for your passion and your power We thank you for your sacrifice, for shedding your precious blood. You didn't have to do it, but we're so glad you did. Thank you for undergoing, Lord God, humiliation and pain on the old rugged cross, that we might be redeemed, that we might be saved, that we might be set free. We thank you and we praise you for all that you have done, what you have yet to do in us and through us. At this time, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. Thank you all so much for joining us on this Memorial Day weekend. Again, we want to just thank God for all of you essential workers and all of you servicemen and women that have served this country, this city, this nation. And we praise God for you all and what you have done, your labor of love. And so if you are moved to give, I encourage you to give on the Bible Way Church app. You can give there. Bible Way Church, you can find it on the App Store, or you can find it in Google Play. You can also go to our website, www.BibleWayChurchColumbus.com. You can go there, and you can give through the website as well. You can also drop it in the mail as well. We are at 453 South Cleveland Avenue, Columbus, Ohio. And so we're Bible Way Church again. And I'm Pastor Tim Latta. I praise God for you all joining us here today. And I ask that God will continue to allow you to experience real change. Amen. So God bless you all on Facebook. Everybody on Zoom, we're going to go ahead and we'll have a few announcements by Brother Mike. And if I can find Sister Monique, we praise God for all of you all that have joined us. God bless you. Come back here again next week. God bless you all. Thank you. All right, we're going to see if we can find Brother Mike.